Its yellow brick exterior and large storefront windows make this building stand out among the other buildings around downtown Columbia. The large metal letters in the center of the building signify the recently new owners. However, the rest of the building serves as a reminder of its past. Through a few physical transformations and a wide variety of tenants, what remains stable is the foundation of values on which it was built. Commercial enterprise, group unity, leadership, and adjusting with the times. It has been known as the Atkins City Center, Montgomery Ward Building, and Strollway Center. Yet the history begins with the Virginia Building. The Virginia Building was erected in 1911. It was constructed with a stone foundation, brick walls, metal roof, and terracotta accents. The intended purpose of the building was, according to the investors of the building, for commerce, trade, and business transactions. There were four major investors in the Virginia Building. Three of those investors were founding members of the Columbia Commercial Club, which was a precursor to the modern-day Columbia Chamber of Commerce. The Commercial Club was not just instrumental in having the Virginia Building constructed, but for the overall development of the city of Columbia. They helped establish paved roads, they assisted in having downtown Columbia wired with electrical lights, and having the municipal water and light plant built. In addition to the Virginia Building, they also were instrumental in convincing companies to build factories in Columbia. One of those companies was the Hamilton Brown Shoe Company from St. Louis, who built a factory on Wilkes Boulevard. The Hamilton Brown Building was used as a factory until recently, when an eager entrepreneur bought it at a bargain price and renovated it to house the offices of local businesses. This entrepreneur's name is Thomas E. Atkins III, and he is a man with whom we will become much more familiar with later in the documentary. The funding of the Hamilton Brown Shoe Factory was a result from the company striking a deal with the Commercial Club. The deal was contingent on the club raising the money and constructing the building, and the company using it for a set period, eventually receiving the deed. The club raised the money in 2 months and had it built directly after. The investment turned out to be a successful one, employing around 400 members of the community. The Commercial Club had its hands on many of the major developments in the Columbia area. It was not exempt from being a part of the political culture as well. The group was founded in 1906, yet did not allow any women to join until 1919. The University of Missouri, a club in its own right, was far ahead of the Commercial Club in admitting women. It allowed women into the colleges of education and nursing in 1867, and subsequently to all other academic classes in 1871. It is interesting that there were roughly 30 classes of female graduates at the time of the Commercial Club's inception, and they chose to leave women out. The times were changing, but not fast enough. The Columbia Commercial Club housed its offices in the basement of the Virginia Building, and one did not have to look far for similarities in gender relations. In fact, it was just to the second floor tenant of the Virginia Building, Booch's Billiards Club. Booch's Billiards was a popular spot for members of the community, along with students from the university. They've served popular drinks and burgers and offered several tables for the patrons to hustle their friends in a game of pool for many years. Booch's has served as a successful business for a very long time. Even during the Prohibition, it thrived. They served a drink that the men who went there called near beer, which was a non-alcoholic beverage. According to one of the former owners of the building, Francis Hunt, it was not as sophisticated as modern-day O'Doul's or Busch N.A. It was a fuzzy drink that did not resemble anything similar to beer. Booch's is the only original tenant of the Virginia Building that is still in business today. It is currently across the street from the Virginia Building and has been there since the 1930s. Yet the biggest difference is the admittance of women. Much like the University of Missouri and Columbia Commercial Club, Booch's made the decision that they would function better without women. It served as a gentleman's only billiards club, in which Frank Sinclair, the president of the Boone County Savings and Loan, called a place of good competitive sport. Also, much like the University of Missouri and Columbia Commercial Club, Booch's came to their senses and began admitting patrons of all genders in the 1970s, much later than the previous two clubs. With male-only clubs in the Virginia Building, it is only fitting that a strong women's club counteract them. The YWCA was just that organization. According to the YWCA's history, in 1908 they became the first industrial federation to train girls in self-governance. This training could have been what it took to convince the commercial club to allow women into their club 11 years later. While the men were attending their meetings and playing billiards in the Virginia Building, the YWCA was having meetings at the Virginia Grill, home of the famous hot homemade biscuits. Columbia's political culture shifted due to the efforts of the YWCA, and the Virginia Building saw it firsthand. The University of Missouri has made a large and lasting impact on the city of Columbia. The sheer size of the university has made it one of the leading employers in the town and draws a lot of tourism. One way that it is not often looked at, however, is as an exclusive club. When thinking of the university and clubs, one would normally be drawn to the large list of clubs at the university: the MU Adventures Club, Diving Club, Men's Rugby Club, Martial Arts Club, Club Soccer, and the like. One may also be tempted to think about the Greek organizations, such as social fraternities and sororities, or professional fraternities and sororities. Examples include Kappa Alpha Theta or Phi Delta Theta, which both have importance to the Virginia Building. In my case, however, I refer to the university itself as an exclusive club. Much like the organizations that I mentioned, there is an application process in which the credentials of the applicant are reviewed. Upon meeting the requirements, they are admitted for participation. Also like those clubs, dues are paid to continue the participation within the club. Once a participating member, the students receive the benefits of the club. For the university, the main benefit is education. However, other benefits include being surrounded by new people with a chance to network, providing access to discounted exercise facilities, access to extensive book and movie collections, and a certain pride that comes with belonging to an organization. That pride may provoke the student into buying merchandise such as apparel at the campus bookstore or other various stores around town. Three of those students had so much pride that they did not just want to buy that apparel, but wanted to sell it. They own the Tiger Spirit Store, which is housed in the Virginia Building now and has been since 1988. Like the owners of Tiger Spirit, once graduated, students become members of an exclusive club of alumni for life. They will forever have the ability to post their diploma in their office, home, or store it in their basement along with all the pictures of their friends, family, and college parties. The university does not just play a large role in the development of the city of Columbia, though. It also has played a large role in the Virginia Building. Like most businesses around town, the Virginia Building's tenants have relied on the patronage of the university's employees and students. This has been the case since the building's establishment. The Virginia Grill not only relied on the university's organizations to hold their meetings there, they have also advertised to the men and women of the colleges around Columbia specifically for their business. They offered a menu that would rival the home-style cooking the students had from their moms. The Missouri Herald Statesman, also known as the Missourian, was the oldest newspaper west of St. Louis in 1917, and they relied on the journalism students to help staff the publication company. The Ad Sheet, a current tenant of the building, hands out thousands of its own publications to the students of the university, their target market. The Daly Brothers Tailoring Company, the first company to snatch up a center storefront in the Virginia Building in 1911, consisted of two brothers, Early S. and Wallace E. Daly. They opened their store in 1905 to help them pay their way through the university. Their business venture ended up not only paying their way, but becoming their life's work. However, neither the Daly Brothers nor the Tiger Spirit owners serve as the Virginia Building's strongest connection to the university. That title belongs to the current owner, Thomas Edward Atkins III. Thomas E. Atkins III was the aforementioned eager entrepreneur who snatched up the Hamilton Brown Shoe Factory. He was able to do so with the Virginia Building in the year 2000. He bought it from a daughter of one of the Strollway investors.